So to find an integral, the fundamental theorem says I must find the antiderivative first. So this is the antiderivative. Once I have the antiderivative, I'm required to now take the upper and lower limit and plug them in. So this upper limit is going to get plugged in here and here, and the lower limit as well. So that's where step three comes from. So this 2 divided with this 2. So they're equaling 1. So all I have left is this k, take away the x, put k in its place, minus, take away the x, put k in its place.
So clarifying, so once you have the antiderivative, that's going to plug in the intervals?
Yes, you can't plug in the limits until you, in other words, you can't plug in the limits until you have the antiderivative.
Oh.
No, keep going, 2 points. The clarifying statements are always welcome, always help. So. Please.
Where
does
the 2 go between steps 2 and 3?
From here to here?
Yeah.
So what I have here really is this. It's just one big numerator, this times this times this. So these are all factors. So a factor of the numerator can divide with a factor of the denominator. Good question. 2 for Heather. What else? So these divide to make 1. So there's the k. I replace the x with the upper limit. So the fundamental theorem says this. You write it over here. Oh, that's a good word. They're putting with each other.
Oh, sorry.
Don't
sorry, worry. That was my bad.
Okay. Don't even worry. Yes, your question. So the fundamental theorem says that if you're trying to find the integral, I'm writing the symbol f prime, but I could write anything. It doesn't really matter. You're integrating something from wherever to wherever. According to the fundamental theorem, this integral is equivalent to the antiderivative of f prime. Or you could say it's equivalent to the change in the antiderivative. That's why we're plugging the limit. The fundamental theorem tells me that the value of the integral is the same as the antiderivative's change. So k is a constant. It's not a variable at all. It's like, think of k as 5. So 2 times 5 would be 10. I wouldn't be plugging anything in for 10. It's called
all my months in the second half or so.
Oh, don't worry. Anyone else? Anything else here? Let me scroll up. Anyone else bring a specific problem to class that they wanted to get a question here? Let me say it back to you. I think you'll see it if you don't, just ask again. So this is one something. K to the third is just whatever. So I've got one of something, subtract a third of something.
Okay.
Don't worry. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So if I have one of something, subtract a third of something, I now have two thirds of that something. So
I'll get it.
Question. Anyone else? Please, wait.
Okay, this might be not answerable, but on a few of the problems, I got the right answer, but it was like negative instead of positive. And like as I've been like trying to figure it out, I've like, because I like put everything like zero on the right and all this on this side. Does that make sense? And so the signs were different and they weren't coming out the same answer. Is that weird?
I'm not sure. I want to do one of those problems that you did just so I can double check it. So which one? Just pick one of the.
Happens on 46.
Yeah, I want to step back quickly, like the nature's. I got to see what's happening. Sorry.
It's okay. Yeah, I'm
46.
Okay. Yeah, well, what if that's not.
Hey, look. Hey, some things in this class are simply memorized facts, but many things you have to know the why. You have to get the reason why we're doing something. So I'll pay everyone in the room and can tell me why you did this. Maria, I'll pay everyone in the room and can tell me why you did it, Hollywood. You're okay. 2 points. It's not really, I want you to kind of understand just a little bit better. No worries. 2 points for that. Tessa. Perfect. Find where two equations intersect, we set them equal. Let me do that. 2 points. So I solved this. So there are two intersections, positive 2 and negative 2. Question. Please, go. So I've got an equation that says x squared. Are you good to this one? So x squared's got to equal 4. So solving an equation means go find the values of x, which will make the equation true. So negative 2 squared is 4, and positive 2 squared is also 4. That's all. Good question. 2 points. Please.
Wait, is there a reason that we didn't do what we did in the first
example? We did the 5 over the negative 0? No specific reason. I simply, my turn again, Holly.
Oh, sorry.
No worries, you're doing this one. Don't even worry. Move that over there. No reason specifically, Allison. I just looked at it and saw that it was simple enough I could do it a different way. If you had done it this way, like we did in the examples,
yeah. Well,
same thing, so, and then factor. So either way,
okay.
2 points. What else? Okay, so I know I've got this curve, and I've got this other curve that intersects twice. That means I've either got this, or I've got this. But I want to find out whether it's red or green. So pick a value in the middle. 0 is a really easy choice. Let's see. I plug that in. Y would equal 0 squared plus 1. So y would equal 1. Well, this is y equal 5. So this cannot be y equal 1. So this must be the correct point. 0, 1. So I know that the curve is under the line. Question. So that means the integral I'm going to create for finding the area will look like this. Now that will become. Shifting this be from 4 minus x squared. talk about any of that that I've just done, like why I did it, you know, you stated what questions specific. So are you comfortable here? So I know that there's a line y equals 5. I know that the intersections are negative 2 and 2. I don't really know exactly what that looks like, other than I know it must touch both places. So I just make a wild guess. I then took this equation and basically built a quick table.
Yeah.
And said that when the x value is 0, the y value will be 1. So it can't be here. It's got to be there. So now I have memorized it to find the area and look at the rectangles that fit in the space. And I notice that the top of every rectangle touches 5. The bottom of every rectangle touches the function. So the formula is top function subtract bottom function. Okay, now, so please go.
So why can't it be the one that you said that it's where x is 1 and 1, or x is 0 and y is 1? Why can't it be that?
Why did they do it, or talk to someone?
Just why, like, why can't it be the point where, like, x equals 0 and then y equals 1?
The point from, I just don't understand, it's not your problem.
Okay, sorry. Like, when you plug in 0 for x, why wasn't that right?
Plugged in the 0 here?
Yeah.
The purpose of this is simply to figure out whether this curve has this appearance or this appearance. I don't know which, so the test tells me. Because if x is 0 and y is 1, it can't be this curve, because that would be a y value above 5. But that doesn't have anything to do with creating this, really, other than noting the curve on the top is always 5, and the curve on the bottom is always x squared plus 1.
Oh,
that makes sense. Is that your question?
Yeah, yeah.
Point. Anyone else? Like, I don't know if this is.
This is, yep, it's like, I'm good now.
Sure.
But you're
doing it. Well, I'm good here. Anybody else need me to do anything else on this?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone else bring a specific problem to class? 22? Singing or speaking, it doesn't pick up everybody else, right? This microphone back here is an environmental microphone. So it's designed to sit and listen to everything, far and near. That's why I can put it in the back of the room and you can hear me talking. I can plug that into my speaker system and stand up here and talk and it'll amplify my voice. Like it's that strong of a microphone. So what happens though is when I'm recording, it picks up my voice and it feeds it into the speakers. The speakers amplify my voice and picks up that again and re-amplifies what was amplified. And so you get this explosion of kind of amplified sound. So it gets really that really loud hum. You've heard it before, like in church and stuff once in a while. That's a positive feedback loop where it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger and kind of just maxes out the system. It can't go any louder. Negative would be the other way around. It would damp it out. So it would go away. Back to the... systems in the world. Like the one that you probably use more than any other that you've never thought about is your cruise control on your car. So that's a feedback system because the car, you're saying it set the speed here, but what you don't realize is the car has to automatically compensate for hills and, you know, up and down, whatever. So it's got to take off the accelerator, apply the accelerator as it needs to adjust for that. So that's a feedback loop because the car is saying, I want to maintain my speed at 70, but I'm going up a hill, so I've got to apply more acceleration. When you go over the hill, it needs to let off the accelerator, right? If that, most of the time we want a negative feedback loop. That's a controlled loop. It's what we want. If the feedback were wrong, the car would go out of control. Like it would leave the loop and it just accelerate wildly or go all the way to zero without you being able to do anything. So you want it to be typically a negative feedback. So that was kind of useless. All right. Look here. Hey. Hey, look up. So I set them equal to each other. I find the intersection. It says I'm only interested in what's happening in the first quadrant, so I kind of sketch that off. Same thing I did on the last one. I've got to find out which curve is top, which curve is bottom. So I just plug in a value that's easy to identify. X equal 1/2 is right here. So on the curve at x equal 1/2, the y coordinate is x and 1/8. On the line at x equal 1/2, the y value is 8.5. So now I know that the curve is below the line. And we need me to re-talk about that. Please. I'll say it back to you. So I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions because I'm trying to get it to click for you so the memory becomes more perfect. So when they give you an equation, let's ask the whole room. Look, everybody answer this. Okay, when you see an equation, what is the most fundamental purpose of the equation? I've said this since the first day of class. I've said it over and over again many times. You see an equation, what's the fundamental purpose? Come on, more people have got to get this memorized. What's the fundamental reason for having an equation? What do we do with it, David?
Find points on the graph.
You find points. How many knew that? Points. You find points on a graph, okay? So look here. I'm finding points on a graph. I'm plugging in an x. This is the curve. So when x is 1/2, the y coordinate is say it. What is it? That was very quiet. When x is 1/2, what's the y coordinate? 8, yeah, it's hard to say, never mind. 1/2, 8 and 8, okay? That's the point on a curve. On the line, the point is 8 and 1/2, okay? Which is bigger, 8 and 1/2.
We just did both of them. Yeah.
So the curve is below the lines.
I think it was just a setup of it.
Don't worry. It's just a table. You've done that before. Here's the x, here's the y. Just two different y's on it.
Yeah.
Please, you got me. Don't talk when I talk. There's no way to figure out the area that they're asking us to find unless we know the intersection. Like, we have to know where the two curves intersect. Otherwise, we cannot figure out where this area is we're supposed to be finding. So I found the three different intersections. So the curve actually does something like this. But I don't care about this portion because that's not in the first quadrant. Question.
Which ones are the intersections where it says like x times x minus one or something?
So right here you have an equation. So think of it like this. This is a y coordinate on one curve, this is the y coordinate on the other. So you're trying to find the x value where the y values are the same. That's why we set them equal. Now, solving an equation simply means identify the x, which will make the equation true. That's hard right here, so I rearranged to make it easier. Get to here. Still not easy to see what x will make this zero. Still not very easy. Once factored, though, it's easy to see. Because the only way for this to be zero is if one of these three factors is zero. If this is zero, it won't matter what's here and here. Because this would be zero, this would be negative one, this would be positive one. But zero times negative one times positive one is zero. So one of the intersections is x equals zero.
Okay.
If x is negative one, you'd have negative one multiplied by zero, negative one multiplied by negative two, multiplied by zero. What's negative 1 minus 1?
Oh, yeah.
Don't worry. So the other intersection is negative 1.
Okay.
Is that your question?
Yeah, that makes sense. One last question.
Go ahead.
Where did the x equal 1 come from?
Same thing. If I plug in a 1 here, here, and here, it doesn't matter that these two are whatever. This is 1, this is 2. This is 0. Three things multiplied, if one of them is 0, they'll all be 0. So that's the other intersection. Anybody else? Dave, I don't know if I helped you or not.
Yeah.
So you're good? Cool. Okay, new stuff today. So in your notes, put this down, please. it's something that is derived in part from the fundamental theorem, but it's crucial that you keep it separate, because it does have some distinct differences, and they're not the same, so don't get mixed up. No, that's just me. You gotta go and check. I don't know.
This is what random and strange check mark.
All right. Okay, look at your notes as I read it to you. So don't look at me. Look at what you've written down. It's probably easier. Okay, what this says is the derivative. That's why you wrote d over dx. Listen close. Come on. So it says the derivative, d over dx, of an integral. And then you wrote an integral. You wrote a very generic integral. It applied to anything. Yeah. Where you said the limits go from something called g to something called h, and you're integrating out. Everybody with me? Awesome. So the derivative of an integral is equal to, so what you're writing down here is your last derivative rule. You have the other 14 that you've memorized. This is the 15th. You have I'm pretty sure there's no other rules after this one. Okay, to find the derivative of an integral, it's actually the easiest rule you'll ever memorize. All you do is take the integrand itself, unchanged, just the integrand. So whatever this function is, f, you write it down again, but you replace whatever variables are in the function with the upper limit. So this becomes f with h plugged in. You need me to say that again. Multiplied by the derivative of the h. So the way I say it is, the derivative of an integral is the integrand with the upper limit plugged into the integrand multiplied by the derivative of the upper limit. You need me to say that again. The second part is easy because it's exactly the same thing with the lower limit. That's it. Okay? Now, as I said to Aaron, don't mix it up with the fundamental theorem. When we're using the fundamental theorem, we're just doing an integral. When you are doing an integral, you first find the antiderivative and then plug in the limits. So you're finding the antiderivative, plugging in the limits. But when you take the derivative of an integral, you do not find the antiderivative. It's as if the derivative and the integral kind of, hate the word, but cancel each other. So you just take the integrand itself. So notice, this is f, this is f. But that's only when you're taking the derivative of an integral. If you're doing an integral, you must do the antiderivative first. You need further explanation of that. Awesome. So we have that. So we're going to practice that real quick. So turn in your yellow packet to number 1. Number 1, I simply rewrote the problem here. Okay, you don't need to rewrite this again. Number 1, I wrote down the problem. They gave you a formula, capital F. They said capital F is this integral. Okay? Then they say find F prime. Find capital F prime. So you all know that capital F prime would mean the derivative of F. So just like you would in any other problem you've done all year long, if you have an equation for which you need to find the derivative, you simply find the derivative of that equation. So anyone need me to talk more about what I have written here on step 2? Like, it needs to make sense to you that that's a logical sequence. That if they're giving you f and you're supposed to find f prime, you need to find the derivative of f. And here's a place where people make mistakes, so take note, don't make this mistake. Capital F, the input variable of capital F is x. So when you take the derivative, it's got to be d over dx. Don't make this d over dt. You're taking the derivative of capital F. whose input variable is x, so this has to be d over dx.
You need to say that again. Awesome. Okay, now we're going to apply the rule. The rule says the derivative of an integral is, we take the integrand. Just write it down. But in place of variables within the integrand, plug in the upper limit. So there's only one variable in this integrand, it's t. So that t gets replaced with the upper limit, which is x. So that's why I wrote e to the negative x squared. Wave it, can you need to say that again? Cool. Multiplied by d over dx of that upper limit. I'm just applying the rule for finding the derivative of an integral. We want to talk more of that. Minus the exact same steps with the lower limit.
Question. So today's homework, today's concepts are kind of old-fashioned math again. There's not a whole lot of understanding what things mean or why we did it. It's just, here's the formula, use the formula. Okay. So now we just clean it up. This derivative is zero. Zero times whatever is zero. This derivative is one and done. This is the derivative of that integral. This is capital F prime. And we want to talk more about any of that. Please, Dustin.
What do we have? B minus one.
Oh, gotcha. No, good question. Point. E to the zero is absolutely one. Good observation. This derivative is zero. Because the derivative of any constant is zero, and then one times zero would just be zero. No, good question. Super awesome. What else? Sweet. Okay, next thing to put in your notes. So you have this formula. Some people call this the second fundamental theorem of calculus. I'll refer to it as the formula for finding the derivative of an integral, because that's what it is. So we can call it the second fundamental theorem if it's easier, whichever you like. So it's just derivative of an integral. Okay. Another rule, write this down, please. L'Hopital's rule is how you say that. I believe I don't speak French, but I think that's reasonably close. Okay, so it's named after a mathematician, L'Hopital. Again, it's a rule that most people really like because it doesn't involve a whole lot of analysis or understanding. It's just step one, step two, step three. Okay, first thing you need to have in your notes. You are not a, well, you can use it, it just won't work if you get the wrong answer. Okay, L'Hopital's rule only works if this test that I'm about to describe to you is successful. If the test is unsuccessful, don't use L'Hopital's rule. Okay, here's the test. L'Hopital's rule is a way of finding a limit. You have other methods for finding limits. Don't forget them, because L'Hopital's rule doesn't always work. But now you also will have L'Hopital's rule that you can use to find limits, and it will allow you to find some limits that we could not have found without the rule, or it would have been much more difficult to find without the rule. So the test says you plug in the limiting value. So we're going to kind of go back and forth here between a couple of pages. So you want to have kind of two pages of notes here. One page which describes the steps, the other page which is the example. Here's the example. So on this other page, write down this limit problem. So you got one page showing you the steps, one page showing you the example. So we're trying to find this limit. Write that down. And as you're writing it down, I would assume that you would look at that limit and feel like, hey, that looks pretty complicated. H is not approaching infinity. With H approaching infinity, I can often figure out a limit. But H is not approaching infinity, so I've got to look for other things to do. I could look to factor, but this doesn't really factor at all. I guess I could take out an 8. That's not going to really help. So I'm gonna try L'Hopital's rule to see if L'Hopital's rule will find this limit versus the other methods I've tried in the past. Just watching your notes. Okay, good. So here's the test. Back here it said, what we're supposed to do is number one, to test, we plug in the limiting value. In the example I just gave you, the limiting value is zero, okay? If you plug in the limit, just plug it right in. So here I am plugging in the limiting value. Put that in your notes. So you simply plug in the limiting value into the limit proper. You need me to restate anything. I'm not really giving you any whys in this process. It's just learn the process. Okay. With zero plugged in, notice what happens. 1/2 plus zero would be 1/2. So the first term here would be 8 multiplied by 1/2 to the 8. But that's exactly the same as this term, and they're being subtracted, so the top is zero. When you plug in the limiting value, you get a zero on the top. Because the bottom was just h, we get a zero on the bottom as well. Okay, that's a successful test as far as L'Hopital's rule is concerned. You're hoping to get either zero over zero or infinity over infinity. So in your notes, put that down. You're testing by plugging it in. You're hoping that you get 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity. Please.
Do you have negative?
Yes, thank you. I didn't write that down, but it could be like negative infinity over positive, positive over negative, negative over negative, any of those combinations. Keep breathing. Anybody else? Okay, if the test is unsuccessful, you cannot proceed. You have to go find the limit some other way. But if the test is successful, that's good news, because most of the time in this class, they're giving you a problem that with a few more steps, you'll find the answer. Okay, step two, once the test is successful, now what you need to do is, lost my scroll bar. What you need to do now is, hold on, differentiate in terms of the limiting variable, the numerator and the denominator separately. So this is L'Hopital's, the process of L'Hopital's rule. Test first. Now we're going to take the derivative of the top and the derivative of the bottom in terms of the limiting variable. So I'll let you get this brown statement written down, then I'll go back to the examples. So back to the example, we did the test was successful. So here I am taking, look, in this problem, sorry, moving back and forth, in this problem, the limiting variable is h. Pay close attention to that. You must take the derivative in terms of the limiting variable. If there are other variables involved, you're using the limiting variable. So here I am, I have 2 over the h of the top. It's not the quotient rule, it's L'Hopital's rule. You take the derivative of just the top. Write that down in green. You're taking the derivative of just the top. We're ignoring the bottom temporarily. So, step one was test. We've done that. Oops, wrong button. So step one was test. Now we're on step two. We are finding the derivative of the top, and then down here we'll find the derivative of the bottom. That's also part of step two. So I've got ddh of this stuff. Okay. Well, catch up your notes. All right, good. Okay, you've taken the derivative of two things added together. That means you can treat each one separately. This is a constant. There's no h involved at all. So just say it out loud. What is the derivative of a constant? Say it.
Zero.
So this is gone. This one here. It's been a while, but it's not a hard derivative. The 8 is a multiplying constant. So I write that down separately. Now what you have is you have some expression to a number. So I bring down the other 8, multiplied by the expression, raised to the 8, subtract 1, multiplied by the DDH of the expression. So we would need more to talk about that. Catch up in your notes. Just to compliment all those who are taking notes very diligently, there have been studies done who track the difference between, like, just having someone hand you notes versus you write them and think about them as you write them. The people who take notes always do better. Like, it really helps to write it, think about, okay, why am I writing this? Where is this coming from? That's why I pause as much as I possibly can to say, hey, talk about what you just wrote, see if there's something that's bothering you. So, everybody good to hear? Okay, this derivative is easy again because it's two things added. So say it with me. What's the derivative of 1/2? Say it.
Yeah.
Good. What's dh over dh?
One.
1 plus 0 is, say it.
One.
My chorus is not working very well. I'm a very bad conductor. So this is 1. So done with that. All we have is this. So this is the derivative of the top. Any questions? This is the derivative of the top. We have to take the derivative of the bottom as well. That one is extremely easy because that's just dh over dh, which is 1. So the original problem is right here. L'Hopital's rule says take the derivative of the numerator in terms of the limiting variable h, and then do the derivative of the denominator. No question. Points? No.
How is that one again?
Right here.
Yeah.
Let me say it back to you. That if it doesn't click, just keep talking. So you have the derivative of two things added, so we can do them separately. What would be the derivative of 1/2? Good. How about, there you go. You see that? No, a few questions. Rhythm. Anybody else?
Are you just proving on the right side how?
No. So where we were in the notes was, we had written down, sorry, wrong way, that L'Hopital's rule says test first, then differentiate top and bottom. So now we're on step 3. Create a new limit problem. Write down the green step in your notes. Create a new limit problem. I don't think I like 7. It looks like a strange mark. We'll use 8. The L'Hopital's rule says that if the test passes, then the limit of some ratio is going to be exactly the same as the limit of the derivative of the top and the bottom separately. Like you create a new ratio, and then you just find a new limit. L'Hopital's rule says, hey, this limit's hard to find. This one may be easier. Let's try this one. So we're going to create a new limit problem and solve the new problem instead of the original problem. Questions. Back to the example. So this is what I'm doing now. So this was step 2. Here's step 3. Creating the new limit problem. 4 would be the wrong number. So I'm creating the new limit problem. H approaches 0. I take the top divided by the bottom. We create a new limit problem.
talk about that. Say again. Oh, gotcha. So the limiting value doesn't change to Ferdowsi. No worries. So in the original problem, H was approaching zero. In our newly created problem, H still approaches zero.
Question.
2 points. What else? Okay, L'Hopital's rule says, back to your notes, that once you've done step 1, 2, and 3, you just start over. So you go back up to here, and you test again. So it's a process that does not require very much brain power. You just process information. So you do the test. If the test is successful, take derivative up top and bottom, create a new problem, test again. But what happens on the second go-round here is I test here. This is me starting over. I plug in the zero. This time I get a value, which means that's the value of the limit. If this comes out to be 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity again, you're in a loop, and L'Hopital's rule may work, it may not. Sometimes if you just keep going through the loop a few times, you'll get an answer. Sometimes you just get in an endless loop. So. Questions? So, this time, so it's a way to find the limit where finding it originally was difficult, if not impossible. So. Question? Okay, awesome. I'm going to give you one hint for tonight, then we're going to do one together. We may have time for a second one. So, hint. Number, we just did number 1 together. No, sorry, not number 1. We did number 2 together. Look at number 6. And look at number 6. I'm just giving you a hint on this one, then we're working. Different problem together. Okay, number 6 is a limit. Now, my first thought is the other tools that I've learned are often easier than L'Hopital's rule. So I first look to see if H is approaching infinity. It's not, so I can't use those rules, the additive comparison. This isn't factorable, so that's not going to help. So L'Hopital's rule is a good third option. This isn't a ratio. It has to be a ratio for L'Hopital's rule to work. But I noticed that this is 1 over h times ln. Okay? Multiplying by 1 over h is exactly the same as dividing by h. So I immediately changed the problem to look like this. This is exactly the same as the limit as h approaches 0 of natural log 2 plus h over 2 all divided by h. Anyone need to talk about that? Multiplying by 1 over h is the same as dividing by h, so now I have a ratio, which is what I want to use L'Hopital's rule. Okay, leave that alone. Go to the next one here. Look at number 10. Okay, number 10 looks like a pretty awful limit problem. It's the limit of some integral, okay? So I immediately would try L'Hopital's rule because my other rules aren't going to fit. H is not approaching infinity. I don't really know what to do with this, so I just use L'Hopital's rule. So you're all going to work on this for about 5 minutes. To use L'Hopital's rule, you need that new rule for finding the derivative of an integral. So you've got to test first. The test is easy. Look, plug in the limiting value, 0. That makes the integral start at 1 and end at 1. Okay, if you start at 1 and end at 1, you haven't done anything. So as your intuition is telling you, the integral from 1 to 1 is 0. You would need me to restate that. So we plug in the limiting value, which is 0. That gives me an integral from 1 to 1. There's nothing's happening. You're just starting and stopping in the same place. But you could also think of it as the fundamental theorem, that according to the fundamental theorem, integrating from 1 to 1, f prime or whatever, I would find the antiderivative first, f, and then I would plug in the limit. But f of 1 subtract f of 1 is going to be 0. So any integral from 1 to 1 or 2 to 2 or 3 to 3 is always 0. You're integrating a rate of change over a time period, but you're not going over any time. So, anybody else? Okay, work on this one. Go. So the test is successful. If you plug in 0, you get 0 over 0. So use L'Hopital's rule. Go. Stop me if you have a specific question. We'll apply the rule that we just talked about on this problem.
So it just means that you're not. That's what
it's the limit. It's not a. What it's saying is that. Like h in this form. It's 0. So that's undefined. We don't know why. Limit means, though, we're plugging a little bit more than h, a little bit less than h. What coordinate would we get? So right at h, we don't know what's happening. Very, very close to h, we're getting a value.
Yeah, we did.
I'll show you. Do this first.
I love how I am.
No, so it's the d over the h, meaning derivative of two things added. So when you take the derivative of two things added, you can do them separately. But this is a constant.
Okay.
The derivative of any additive constant is
d over dh is a constant.
Okay. So I've got to take the derivative of this. So I've got 8 times this. So it's a multi constant. So take it out. The derivative of this to the 8th power to bring down the 8th power. So to test it, you look at your limit. The limit says h approaches 0. So you plug in the limiting value. So where it says 1 plus h, I put 0. Where it says h on the bottom, I put 0. That gives me an integral from 1 to 1. And any integral from 1 to 1 is going to be 0. Divided by 0. So the test passes. This stuff is. Yeah, no, this is one where for our class, I don't think you can do that for a lot of this. Most of the time I want to know what I'm doing. This one, it's just kind of like it's a please raise your hand, ask me to say anything twice, ask me to say it differently, whatever helps, okay? You don't have to have a question, you can just ask me to say it again. I performed the test is successful. We're going to talk more about the test. Okay, now I'm going to find the derivative of the top, and then the derivative of the bottom.
So, let's pull this over a little bit.
Right there. D over dh, because you always take the derivative in terms of the limiting variable. There are two variables up here, h and x. You take the derivative in terms of the limiting variable. So don't mix them up. Question. Okay, cool. I need to find this derivative. That's why I gave you that new formula. Okay. The formula is easier to just apply than it is to read. All you have to do is find the integrand. Here it is. You write down that integrand. But in place of the x in the integrand, plug in the upper limit. Then multiply by the derivative of that upper limit. So anyone want me to do that again, say it differently, whatever you want? You're just applying the rule. We're not using the fundamental theorem. If it were the fundamental theorem, we'd be finding this antiderivative. We're not. We're taking the derivative of the integral. We're not finding the integral. We're taking the derivative of the integral. You want me to talk more here? Please.
Why did you do the d over dh of 1 plus h?
Gotcha. The rule requires it, that's all. So the rule for finding the derivative of an integral is take the integrand, write it down, plug in the upper limit, then multiply by the derivative of that upper limit. Question, support. Anybody else? Okay, do the same thing with the lower limit. So look here. So that's the exact same thing with the lower limit. Now, it's not always going to happen this way, but it is common. This derivative is zero. Zero times whatever is zero, so you don't have to worry about this at all. But I would write it down so you are memorizing the rule properly so the AP test writers don't fool you. I have seen AP questions where this does not become zero. Questions? Okay, this is also easy. Let's have everybody raise their hand and answer this. Raise your hand if you know this, what this is going to become. Come on, show your hand. Raise your hand if you know what this is going to be. Right here. Help everybody to know. What's this going to become? Right here. So David? How many knew that this was 1? Point. 1 times that leaves just the root part. So we just have that. So that's the derivative of the top for L'Hopital's rule. Keep going. See if you can finish it. So, stop me if you have a question. Yeah, sorry. Hey, I wrote this wrong on the board. This should be H. I just wrote it wrong. We're always taking the truth. Don't be questioning. In terms of the limiting variable. So, L'Hopital's rule is easier to memorize, like just kind of verbally than written. So, we do the test by plugging it in. 0 over 0 is good news. We proceed. We take the derivative of the top and the bottom. Create a new limit top. Let's start over. We did. It's just a rule that's new to you. So, we just use that new rule and get the derivative of the top. Now, what's the derivative of the bottom in terms of it? Just 1. So we get a new limit problem.
Oh, this one. Minus.
Create the new limit problem here. Actually, over here. So here's your new limit problem right there.
We are finding the drift, yeah. There is another way to find the drift, but it's horrible. It's really bad. This is the best way. Yeah, there is another way, but you know, you really don't want to go down the other path. I'm very serious about that. It's really bad.
So you create a new limit problem, and then you just like you did at the beginning, you test it. So you take a to the front of the for like an h equals 0. Yeah, start over, take a number. Don't ever get a number, then you're in the very, very close to zero, you get 3. That's what limit means. Like a little, like tiny bit less than zero or tiny bit more than zero, this will equal 3. That's the idea of a limit. So, questions? Okay, here's the list of homework problems. Write them down. One, two, six. 10, 11, 12. So 1, 2, 6, 10, 11, 12. 14, 17, 18. 21 through 28. That's it. 1, 2, 6, 10, 11, 12, 14, 17, 18, 21 through 28. Yeah, we did 1, 2, and 10 together. And I give you a hint for 6 that we can get you started. 4.